Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Fatback 4 podcast. This one is not live this week because it's just not. We're trying something different. Myself, Gav, you can see Matt on screen, you can see Grizz on screen. Yeah, we are 6 days out from Liverpool, going to Old Trafford and beating Manchester United in the Premier League. This is probably the first preview of the week you're going to listen to on any podcast, and it will be the best. We've decided that before we've started. Let's get into it. Let's go. Grizz, you told me during the week that you don't feel Liverpool will beat Manchester United at Old Trafford next Sunday with a 4:30 p.m. kickoff. Give me the reason for that before we start going through game, you know, the game, players, tactics, everything else.
Gav, it's just the feeling I have with playing these cunts at Old Trafford. Our record's just not great there, is it? I don't think we've won there since 2014. Klopp's definitely not won there. Mm-hmm. I think it was Klopp's first victory, wasn't it, last season? Against them home and away. Or maybe. Actually, no, apart from the Europa Cup, we beat them as well. But in the league, let's talk about in the league. It's just one of those grounds, just one of those games, it's just one of those... The atmosphere that's created, and you know, we just basing it on our performances in the past haven't been great. I think it's fair to say, and you know me, I'm a positive top red. I think it's nothing. I am
absolutely not.
I think it's fair to say it's the one fixture where we've been accused, or we can be accused, of freezing. Especially last season. Last season was probably the most disappointing, one of the most disappointing trips to Old Trafford in terms of, you know, they were shambolic. And then on top of that, they were forced to make three substitutions in that first half. And we still froze. We still didn't capitalise. I know Bobby went off for us and Studge came on, which I thought was, you know, a bad call by Klopp as well. But hindsight's a wonderful thing. It's just one of those, Gav, you know, I hope and I pray and I love to be proved wrong and then you lot take the piss out of me for months to come. You know, no better feeling than being on the receiving end of your abuse. I just can't, you know, it's just my prediction. I just can't see us winning there. We'll get a draw. We won't get beat by them, but I just can't see us winning there, Gav.
Okay, me and Matt will talk you around before this is finished. Matt, Grizz mentioned there that we went there last season. We were in good form. We were flying. They weren't great. But he still had a little bit of a bounce from Solskjaer. He still believed in what he was trying to do. They did have to make three subs in the first half, and we should have capitalised. But even going on last year, Matt, I think this is a much different Liverpool side and a much different scenario Liverpool are going into next Sunday.
Yeah, absolutely. It's not just that. You look at everything in Klopp's reign so far, and he's always improved. So if you're looking at the past results and think that's something to take away of anything in the future, then you're completely wrong. If we've got a team that we struggle to beat, he is working relentlessly trying to find a different way to beat them. And that's exactly what we'll do on the weekend. We'll find a way to beat this team where we may have struggled slightly against them in the past at Old Trafford. Not too much. We haven't taken any batterings or anything. So it doesn't need too much tweaking, but he will definitely have a plan. And it's not like Solskjaer, some worldy manager who's going to pull out some tactical tactical plan which will be able to get rid of our front three or the fullbacks. We're going to go there and we're going to win 2-0, 3-0. Easy.
Okay. Matt, straight in with an early prediction. I'll try to talk him into even more than that by the end of this. But, Grizz, just, we know our strengths. We know there's very few weaknesses in us, but a lot of people are talking over the last couple of weeks, this podcast included, about just how poor United are. I think I'll have a United fan on Friday night, doing a small preview from their side, I suppose, on the game. But, you know, people are saying, you know, last season, but just looking at this season, Grizz, how bad is this United side? And just, if you look, even from last season, how bad are this United side, Grizz?
They're worse than last year, and loads of us took the piss out of last year. They haven't improved in any aspect. In fact, they've probably gone backwards. They've gone backwards. I mean, Matt, I will agree with Matt's point about Klopp always improving against teams or always learning from past experiences. Whoops, there goes my
Shazza, stay still.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, so, yeah. Hold on, Gav. Why don't you go to Matt for a couple of seconds?
For people listening to this tomorrow on the download, Grizz's camera fell over there and the panic in his face is unbelievable. Matt, I'll come to you and I'll ask you the same question. Even going from last season, you know, they signed Wan-Bissaka, that they all raved about. They signed Harry Maguire for a record fee for a defender. They signed Daniel James from Swansea and it seems like they're hanging the hat on him for the season. But, you know, you don't want to be too premature in your predictions, but how bad are they? Is because every time I watch them, I just think they're open at the back, very little midfield, and they've gone completely and utterly blunt up front.
Yeah, they're terrible, aren't they, as a team? I mean, individually, they've got enough players to make top four, but they're not clicking.
I don't think they've individually got players.
It doesn't look like they're listening to, or he has any tactics. And as well as going into this, you've got Klopp who's concentrating on United. You've got Solskjaer firefighting left, right, and centre, about talking about players out of form, dropping players, all this type of stuff. And he's got so much on his mind at the moment when all we've got is them. It's another bonus to us. But it's a terrible United team. They'll be 8th this season, 7th, 8th, hopefully, unless they kick him out. I hope he gets a few little wins, maybe a run in the Europa League just to keep him in as long as possible. It's beautiful to see. I couldn't be happier.
Yeah, like when you're looking at it, and I've said it like the back end of last week, and I'll say it this week plenty of times, I've seen loads of average Liverpool sides beat really good United sides. So that's where I can kind of understand where Grizz is coming from, because, you know, all these cliches of, you know, form goes out the window and it's a derby and it's this, that and the other. It doesn't matter in this game. If you look back, I think the form sides usually win it, but there's always something in there where somebody throws a mad one in.
I mean, look how many times we've gone up there or they've come to us and sort of they've been the top dogs and we've always managed to pull out a performance against them. And then going back further, when we were the top dogs, they always used to manage, you know, to get performance
against us. But I don't think their players give enough of a shit to get that bounce against us.
I don't think they believe in themselves.
Like our Liverpool players, they were always fighters. It was that type of team. No matter who was in there, you always had like a Gerrard or a man or something. Do you know what I mean? You always had fighters in the centre. None of them are. None of them care.
No, and that's why I disagree with your point about they've got the players to get top four. I really don't think they've got a calibre of player. I mean, that midfield is, you know, again, we're talking about Man United and we're about to play them next week. So this podcast could come back to bite us hard in the arse. But their midfield is shambolic if you look through it. I mean, I'm adding Pogba or minusing Pogba. I don't give a shit. Even with him or without him, it's an awful midfield. And comparing
I know we laugh at Fred, but Fred is a player. And then put him under a different manager and different team, and he can play in Premiership pretty well, top four.
I don't know enough about Fred. I haven't watched enough of him, basically because he hasn't played a hell of a lot for United. Like when you're looking at
twice.
But the thing is, like, when you look through, there is so much frailties in them. But I think one of you's hit on it there. I think, Matt, they don't seem to have the fight in them. Oh, like, I watched them away at West Ham, and I tell you how bad it was. I watched the game. I ended up having to watch it later on Match of the Day. And there's a corner to United, and the BBC commentator starts talking about Sunday trips to his grandmother's and the dinner they used to have and how boring it was. And he was basically, you know, comparing it to this game. That's how bad it was. Then they go 1-0 down to a poor goal and nothing comes from them. They go 2-0 down. They should be 2-0 down. Actually, Maguire misses a chance where he could have maybe put United ahead or put them level. And then they just go 2-0 down and nothing again. And everything's so slow and lethargic. There's no interplay. They're looking for one piece of magic from somebody and literally giving lads the ball 50 yards out and going, here, you go and do something, you know. It's a far cry from the first day when they looked really good on the break against Chelsea, although Chelsea were very, very naive in that game. But, Matt, I want to go through United's team, what we think United's team will be and their lineup and their tactics going into this game before we go to Liverpool, because I think Liverpool's is a little bit more straightforward. So, Matt, De Gea is going to be in goal, but What way do you think they'll go back four? Because I think they will go 4-3-3. So what way can you see it going?
He'll probably want experience, so he'll put Young in there. Obviously, you got Maguire. Dalot, right back.
Is Wan-Bissaka injured? Back.
He's been missing, hasn't he? Is he back?
I'm not too sure on Wan-Bissaka. I think he might be okay.
He wasn't in the squad for Newcastle, but I don't know about his injuries.
Yeah, so I have a feeling Wan-Bissaka is back.
You've asked the worst person ever to talk about another team's lineup.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, but
the lad barely knows our lineup.
But come here, Matt, I'll put it to you this way: if Wan-Bissaka is fit, he got Wan-Bissaka, Lindelof, Maguire, and you feel Young. I'm not too sure, and I think he might be injured. But that's the back four you think he'll go with. Grizz, would you agree with that?
Yeah, I think Shaw's touch and go, but that's realistically their best back four at the moment. So we're talking Wan-Bissaka, who's come back from an injury. Maguire, has Maguire played both games for England? Well, he will play both games for England, won't he? Mm-hmm. So Maguire, Lindelof, and then Shaw's apparently 50-50, but it wouldn't make much difference whether it's him or Ashley Young. I mean, they're as bad as each other, in my opinion. But Ashley Young, yeah. Ashley Young actually had a decent enough game last season, from what I remember. I know we take the piss out of him, and I can't stand him. Like, he's the biggest prick. One of the biggest pricks in football.
Poor Kel.
And in football. I'm not in football. And how he's managed to stay in that squad and around that first team is just a testimony to where Man United are.
Is he captain?
I think when he plays, he's club. I think he's club captain, actually. Yeah, Matt. Well done.
That's fucking beautiful, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, he's their club captain, and that's shambolic if you think about it. Because you know he hardly ever plays, and when he does play, he's awful. When he's been playing on that left wing, or sometimes he gets shunted out to the right wing. Oh, actually, they've got a youngster who's been playing really well. I'm not going to even try to pronounce his name. But it begins with TZ.
Twanzabe.
Yeah, that's it. He's in your FBO team, yeah? He's the one who's their bright spark, actually. I mean, you know, people talk about Wan-Bissaka, but I don't think he's been, you know, nothing special. But this kid's good. So he may keep his place in the team. But yeah, you know, at the end of the day, it's a pretty...
It's Hodgson here and stuff. That's how embarrassing it is, isn't it?
It's pretty bad. There's no consistency in their back four. As we're discussing, we don't even know their strongest. I doubt if they know their strongest at this stage. And, you know, any team that doesn't know their strongest back four, I think it's a bad indictment on them.
I think they do. Also,
last season, they went after Trent a lot. And I don't think he's got that frailty in his game anymore. So that tactic of theirs is out the window, I think.
Well, you see, that car left full because, you know Salah's going to play up there and we'll get to the Liverpool team later. But what happens is Young is quite aggressive. He's quite physical for a guy that started out as a left winger.
Well, he tries to be.
Well, he is. And Shaw can be quite good going forward, Shaw. He's a good footballer. You know, the fitness and different things is a side issue. He's actually a good footballer when you look at him play. But positionally, I don't think he's great and I think he could be opened up down that side. But I think they do know the best back four, and I think it is Wan-Bissaka, Lindelof, Maguire, Shaw. I think that is the best back four. There is a case for that guy, Twanzabe. He played really well in the League Cup game where he went through on penalties. He's kind of got decent reviews when he's played for them. But in midfield for them, Matt, there's talk that Pogba has fractured his toe. He won't be in the game. He's out. It could be 3 or 4 weeks. I don't believe that. I'm going to say that right now. I have a feeling that Pogba will turn up fit next Sunday. But I think they will go on three in midfield. Matt, if I gave you a midfield of McTominay, Matic, Pogba, would you disagree with that? Can you see anything different?
Yeah, it would be Fred.
You think you'd go with Fred instead of?
Yeah, Fred in the centre, McTominay and Pogba, if Pogba's playing. If not, it'll be maybe Matic. James.
That would be Matic, Matt. Fuck off, James. James Bezos.
David James.
David James. Matt's on the cans.
But as you go,
Grizz, while Matt looks up Manchester United's squad list and picks another name from the top of his head. First of all, do you think Pogba makes it, or do you think that's just all, you know, mind games or that they could be trying?
Well, the thing is, yeah, I don't get what kind of mind games that could possibly be, because I really don't see it making much difference to them the way they're playing, or to us how we would set up. I think
I'll tell you the difference it makes.
Go on.
I think the difference it makes is that Pogba is probably the only player they have in midfield that can turn on a ball deep in his own half and set a player away with a stunning fucking pass. I think that's the difference it makes.
I kind of agree with Grizzly. I don't think it changes anything we do.
Oh no, I don't think it changes anything we do. But just
it's a pointless mind game if they try it.
Yeah.
The talk is he's fractured a toe or something like that, 4 weeks. But we'd have to wait and see. Grizz, that holds no fear for you, does it? Whether it's Pogba, McTominay, Matic, Fred.
I hear what you're saying. You know, when we were talking about, you know, the way they're playing, or was it Matt saying something about they're looking for something to happen, something different to happen? Mm. And I suppose Pogba is that X factor in that team where he could just put one in the top corner from 30 yards out. You know, very rarely does it happen these days, but he can do it. We've seen him do it before. So I suppose from that angle, yes, Pogba would be an X factor. But if he's struggling and he's 50-50 in terms of fitness and he's coming up against probably the fittest midfield in the world, the most high energy, high pressing, you know, I'd welcome that. I don't think it's an issue. If Fred plays, I think he's an awful player. I don't agree with anyone who says Fred's a Premiership player or a top 4 or 6 Premiership midfielder. I just don't agree with that. He's awful. I've been impressed with McTominay, and I have been impressed with him not only this season but last season as well. I mean, you know, in a sinking ship, you know, he was the shining light.
He's impressive in the way that he tries more than anyone else in the team. I think that's what you're looking at, Chris. I don't think it's...
He's young, he's energetic, he's not the worst on the ball, he's not got much creativity to him. But, you know...
He's another Darren Fletcher.
Yeah. I mean, that's not a bad shout. That's not a bad shout. Yeah, good shout.
Thanks.
He's another Darren Fletcher, but he's more physical than Darren Fletcher. The guy is an actual fucking giant, you know, for his size as well. So he's the only kind of shining light in their midfield, which is again, you know, a poor indictment of where their club is. When you're talking at... Is 19 or something, Matt? Or Gav?
19-20, I think. Yeah, he's
19 confirmed.
Matt's confirmed it as 19.
So I mean, you know, as a 19-year-old to be the shining light, like sort of, we'll go on to James, who's an attacker, but Matt's got him playing in central midfield, holding. You know, to be
mind games,
to be the shining light of a club like Man United again. You know, it's fucking poor, isn't it? But Pogba's mind games, or whether it's mind games or not, I don't think it affects us.
Okay. I think it will a little bit if Pogba's on the pitch. I think it will make a difference as to who we pick. We'll get to that later. Matt, the front three for United. Talk is Martial is back fit. Rashford is fit. Daniel James looks like he's a shoe-in to play. Simply because
he's in midfield. Being,
well, if he doesn't play hold in midfield, it looks like he will play up front. Anybody watching this on YouTube after this will realise that if you have epilepsy, don't watch, because Grizz has gone absolutely rash with the camera.
You need one of them warnings at the beginning.
I know, yeah. Yeah.
Flashing lights.
Yeah, absolute Mongo alert. But the up front... up front, you're looking at, Matt, you're looking at options there of Daniel James, Marcus Rashford, Jesse Lingard, Anthony Martial, probably Matic if they want to play someone in behind or off the right, and Mason Greenwood, I think, is this guy that keeps coming on for them. But looking at it all fit and already, I think he may go James, Rashford, Martial. Matt, if that lines up on Sunday against you, what are you thinking?
You're rubbing your hands together, aren't you? It'll be one of the easiest attacks that Van Dijk's come up against this season.
Do you think so?
Yeah. It's pretty shit. For what Man United are, the whole team, you go through what we've done here, you've gone through it, and it's just It's just terrible. It poses no threat, and that's why Grizz is an idiot for declaring a draw, and he's just taking the coward's way out because he's not afraid to put his he's not afraid to put it on the line. So as I said, we're getting 2-0. They're not scoring against Van Dijk, Matip, Robertson, and Alisson. Alisson will play. They're not scoring against that.
Okay, Grizz, if a front, I'll put the front three of James off the right, Martial off the left, Rashford up front. I'll put that one to you. Is that how you think they'll line up, or do you see any difference? And same question again, what sort of threat do you think they'll pose?
Martial, will he be rushed back into a game like this?
I have a feeling you might probably go with Lingard, simply because
I think Lingard's injured, isn't he?
Well, even though he's an up-and-coming star at 27, I think his experience in games like this may get him.
Do you know? It's mad because Mata hasn't performed ever for the last God knows how long, but when he plays he plays well against us. So the thing is, I've got an inkling Mata might come into their team somewhere.
The thing with Mata is, Griff, the thing with Mata is, when he did play well against us, they had a really solid two in midfield that he could rely on and then let him go forward and kind of drift into spaces. If you let Mata drift off into spaces and leave a two in midfield of McTominay and Matic or Fred or whoever it is, I think they get absolutely annihilated. But look, we've gone through the United side, what we think it might be. There might be a few different changes in there. Maybe Pogba, something at left back. Maybe a different change up front. They haven't got massive options. But what I can make from the three of us is that we're extremely comfortable in whatever way they line up.
Well, they're definitely, what we do know is they're definitely going to play young James on the left. And he'll be up against Trent. And as Matt says, Trent has... You can see the increased confidence as well and just the aura around him. Trent no longer plays like a child or a kid who is still learning the trade. I mean, he is learning the trade professionally in terms of he's still learning. You never stop learning as a player. But you can see the maturity in his performances. Well, I can, definitely. And I don't think he'll be overruled. In fact, I think James, you know, may think, well, I'm playing probably against, you know, playing up against probably one of the best attacking right backs, you know, in Europe. And, you know, I've got to keep an eye on him going forward as well.
There's the issue.
So I think David James, the speedy winger, I think he's...
Who sometimes plays holding midfield.
Holding midfield on Matt's FIFA. But I think Martial, I think through desperation, they will bring him back in and probably go through the middle. And then you'll have Rashford coming in off the right. So, I mean, I think that's the most likely they will go for as well, yeah.
But we're all pretty comfortable no matter what option they use, aren't we? Like Matt,
pretty much, that's the thing, yeah.
Matt, there's nowhere where you go, oh, if they do this now, this could get messy. There's nothing there that's worrying you at all, is there?
No, not at all. Not this team, not this Klopp, Liverpool team. It runs through this. It runs through United. The atmosphere might be a bit spiky. We get 65% possession in the first 10 minutes and just shut them up. And then we just turn the screw, do what we've been doing.
And let them walk off scraps, like.
We win 3-0.
But lads, do you know what?
It's gone from Matt's, like, we're recording 24 minutes now, and Matt's gone from, I think we do 1 or 2. That's 2-0. I think we win 3-0. It's just 3-0. If we get to the hour,
I'm convincing myself.
After every sip, it'd be 8-1 by the time I finish.
But you know,
one is only because he spilled some of his beer. That's all.
But do you know, Matt talked about the atmosphere being a bit spiky. I don't think it'll be as ferocious and as hostile as it was last year.
Yeah, I think it might be a little bit fearful from them.
Because last year they were, I think we did touch on it, that last year they were coming off a bit of a run, weren't they, Gav? A slight bit of form.
They weren't great. It was a great chance for us to go there and win. They weren't great. But you see, I think if we'd have went there and Mourinho was still in charge, I think it would have suited us a lot better. Excuse me. I think it would have suited us a lot better. But just a new experience for Solskjaer being manager there, Liverpool coming to town, I think it just got them up a little bit. But now, when I look at it, I think Solskjaer goes in absolutely shitting himself, for one. I think he doesn't know what way to, he doesn't know what way we're going to play. We've come out at times, Grizz, and you've seen it. We've gone 4-4-2 at times. We've gone 4-3-3. We've gone times where we just sit too deep and we play a 4-2-3-1. We can shift this team around so many ways.
Do you know something, Gav? Great point by you there. Last week's change in formation, Gav, that he's put in, obviously he's put in for Leicester, whatever, but I think that's put a little doubt in other coaches' mind with playing sort of Salah through the middle and then two number 10s in Bobby and Mane.
Yeah.
You know, it's just a different... it's just a different way of playing for us, different weapon.
I think the way home for us on Sunday is definitely making this pitch as big as it can be, and it's a big pitch, you know. I think the way home for us is making this big. Like,
are we
Matt
good
said,
on big pitches, Matt?
Well, not great on big pitches. I'll get the ruler out. I'll check the dimensions of the pitch, and then it'll give us a... I can get you a percentage chance on victory. That's being widely proven. But making this pitch, which is already big, making it as big as we can, and like Matt said, getting hold of the ball and holding it there, even just holding it for 20 minutes and just playing them and playing them and playing them. And listen, players get tired, you know, if they're running around chasing ball. And if you make that pitch that big, you know, it goes back to game management, where we kind of go for people's throats. Whereas I find when Liverpool play, if we pass and pass and pass, make a pitch big, openings become available. One, because we're really good. And two, because the players we have are so fast and so instinctive in what they do around the box that they can open teams up at will at times. So I fully agree with Matt. You go and you control these for the first 20 and it kills the crowd and they're walking off scraps. We'll have to wait and see. But the three of us seem very comfortable regardless of what options they come up with and where they might try penetrate. Everyone's looking at Trent and down that right hand side, but you
Matt
have to
Grizz,
wait.
He thinks we're drawing.
Yeah, well, we'll get to that. I think he might change his mind before we're finished. But you know, Trent going the other way. Trent is one of our five attackers. Always remember that, right? Always remember it, especially when you're looking at what our midfielders do. Always remember Trent is one of our five attackers. Matt, you mentioned something earlier going on to Liverpool now. Alisson, fit,
yeah,
ready. You fully 100% expecting to start this Sunday?
Yeah, I called it when he got his injury back for United game.
Yeah, you did.
Grizz didn't.
No.
No, he plays. He's back. He's had his few weeks off. This international break actually came at a really good time for us.
I agree.
For once. And yeah, we're full squad again now.
Grizz, I have a feeling he doesn't start. Would you disagree?
I disagree, yeah. I think as well as Adrian has done, and he has surprised me. I wasn't always comfortable with him at the start, but I guess it was natural, you know, totally out of the blue, you know, playing at such a high level. I think he surpassed everyone's expectations, and credit to Adrian for fitting in so well. But I think the main man comes back. He just oozes calmness, doesn't he? And he brings that sort of aura to the rest of the team as well. And everyone just kind of just relaxes and concentrates on their own game, as opposed to thinking about back passes and when to and when not to. You know, as the case was with Adrian, you know, let's admit it. Now they can totally play their natural game. I think he comes to the team personally as well. I agree with Matt. And rightly so, in my opinion, as well. We've got, as well as Adrian's done, sentiments go out the window. We've got a league title to win here, and you know, Alisson is one of the top keepers in the world. So you bring him back.
You know what? I just have a feeling Adrian might start. I know. I take Matt's point. The international break is coming at a great time for us. He was back in full training, I think, before the international break. He'll have 2 weeks under him, but I don't know. Can a keeper get back to full fitness and full sharpness 2 weeks without an actual game? I'm not too sure. But like we said about United, we're comfortable in what we feel the options they have and the way they may approach the game. I'm comfortable no matter what goalkeeper starts.
You're always gonna have the Alisson. So what are you gonna say for the next game? Oh, I don't know. Can we bring him back after such a long layoff? you know, you've got to bring him back.
That's a fair point. Yeah, that is a fair point. I just think, like, let's be honest about it, Grizz. If that was a central defender going into this game, you probably, and I think the majority of people say, it's probably not the right game to bring him back. He hasn't really played, but we're playing, you know, I know we play Spurs next, but if we were playing, I don't know, fucking name a team, you know, Sheffield, Watford at home next week, you'd be going, that's the game to put him back in because we'd be on top. It's a foregone conclusion, you know, the kind of way. But
we're
look,
not playing.
No, we're not. So
you just got to throw him in.
Right, well, if you throw him in, we throw him in. I haven't seen many massive updates on his fitness and whether he's 100% now, or it may come out during the week. But Matt, I'll stick with you on your word when you say he's back. If Alisson's back in goal, it's just another massive, massive thing for us to have in our team.
So I tell you how we compare it, Gav. Do you know you said his face is centre back?
Mm.
Do we all agree? And I'm sure we do. Alisson is our Virgil van Dijk equivalent, right? So would do we bring back 80-90% Virgil van Dijk in a game like this? We do. And you know, Alisson,
but the drop off from Alisson to Adrian is not as big as the drop off from van Dijk to Lovren.
Lovren maybe no, but to Mata in the current form,
well, Mata will play anyway. That's, he's not as replaced,
he's playing. Mata's not the replacement,
you know. Hey, you're looking at Lovren or Gomez because Mata is his partner. You can't say, oh, the drop-off to Matip isn't that big, because it doesn't make a fucking difference. He's the man playing beside him anyway.
Yeah, but Gomez...
Yeah, but that doesn't suit his point.
No, it does. I'll tell you how I can switch it, because you got to remember, I'm comparing it to an informed Adrian, yeah?
It's grand. I'll cut your last point there. It's grand. Come on.
No, it's not. Listen.
I'm only messing.
We're comparing Alisson coming back to an informed Adrian, yeah? Mm-hmm. So therefore, we have to be fair, compare Virgil van Dijk coming back and partnering with inform Lovren and a Gomez.
No, it would be Lovren and a Matip.
Either.
Yeah. It's not either. It's Lovren.
I still don't think
left sided centre back is Lovren.
I still
So Matt, you've just helped my point in the fact that you bring back Virgil and you bring back Alisson as a result.
Yeah, no, I'm saying that's right.
He's always stuck with that point. I'm just making the point that if it was a centre half, and I know where you're coming with the Van Dijk thing, in fairness, we're slagging here, but I know where you're coming from. If Van Dijk's at 80-90%, you bring him back because he's just fucking ridiculous. You know what I mean? It's a fair point. I don't know. I'd love to see an update on Alisson during the week. And
I'll give you an update tomorrow.
Okay.
I've just given you an update.
Well, Matt has given me the update, and so I'm going to go with him. So we're going Alisson in goal. Fucking hell, that was a long way around just saying who's in goal. Back four, Matt, Trent, Matip, I'm presuming, is back. I haven't looked up. I don't follow injury updates and stuff. So we're going to go Trent, Matip, Van Dijk, Robertson. There's no arguments there at all, Matt. Is there? Or any doubt that it's going to be that?
No. That's it.
You're happy with that? Okay.
Yeah, I mean, Matip again, it would be Matip would be the only concern fitness-wise, and sort of, you know, you'd say, oh, Lovren didn't put a foot wrong, does he stay in there? But no, Matip was in absolute colossal form before his injury, and if Matip's fit, then rightly so, he comes back into the team as well.
Yeah. I know where you're coming from, Grizz, but the difference is Matip had a knock. He wasn't 3 months out, you know what I mean?
But Matip's physique is such, and I know in it because I've got similar physique.
Called scientist, right.
Similar physique. You're just the same colour as him, that's it.
You're going to talk about compound stress fractures now.
You'd be better off talking about compound interest now than focus compound fractures.
We'll go on.
Go on.
I was just buzzing off you guys when I was joking.
I
compared his physique to mine, you fucking fucked hard. Because I'm buzzing. But on a serious one, right?
Yeah.
Apparently, obviously, you know, I'm not a sports scientist, right? But
could you imagine Grizz going into Leighton Orient going, I'm a sports scientist?
but Matip has known to sort of recover from injuries slower than others, and sort of as a result of physique, maybe not.
Yeah.
But he'll be fine. If he's fit, he's fit. And he gets back into the team.
So you're not a sports scientist, but you're telling me how he's going to recover. I love this. But no, look, the back four, that's the back four. The midfield is interesting, Matt. You know, you're going to presume Fabinho plays. Did Fabinho go away, Brazil?
Yeah.
Right.
But he's only played... He's only played 10 minutes of both games coming up.
But it's in Singapore, though, isn't it?
Yeah, but the good thing about Singapore is that they're ahead of time of us, so they come back a bit earlier than if it was in, you know, Brazil or South America. I don't think he played at all in the game against Senegal.
No, sorry, he didn't come in. He didn't come on against Senegal, but against Nigeria today, he played the last 10 minutes.
Okay, so he's played 10 minutes of football. Firmino is just Firmino, so I'm not... No, we'll get onto that later. So, Matt... I'm going to give you a midfield of, and I might surprise you, I'm going to give you Fabinho, Keita, Henderson. And the reason for that is that when Wijnaldum's off, literally carrying the Dutch on his back, on his own. I think the Dutch may have a friendly in midweek? They might have another game in midweek, I'm not sure, because they played their second game. He's back this Thursday, so they would have played on the Tuesday or Wednesday, is that right?
Yeah.
But can you see a map being Fabinho, Wijnaldum, Henderson, the usual?
Yeah, I mean, Genie, at the start of the season, he's had a full pre-season. He didn't play too much in the World Cup. Yeah, he's fine. Genie will come in. He's not tired. He's fine.
Okay, and he told you this, did he?
Yeah, I'm a sports scientist.
All right.
If you look at his physique, he's the type of player that can play Wednesday, Sunday, not an issue.
Yeah, and you know when Matip was injured, and you're being a sports scientist, did you say to Matip, listen, Grizz is extremely similar to you, and he's often being sick on a Friday, but he's in work on a Monday, so cop yourself on. Have you said this stuff to Matip?
He said he's fine, he'll crack on.
Okay, cool. Well, there you go, Grizz. Same physique, same working mentality, you know, get up and go attitude. I want to ask you something later, Grizz, about the car accident you were in yesterday. I'll talk to you in a minute about that. Grizz, are you going Fabinho, Wijnaldum, Henderson as well, or have you any changes in mind?
Yeah, I mean, Henderson was dropped from from our last league game. Probably with a view to this game. Klopp probably knew that he's going to start both England games and therefore sort of gave him a break in that Leicester game. So I'm assuming Hendo starts as captain, and then Fabinho, as we've said, hasn't played much. Even though, look, I'm a massive Fabinho fan.
Don't forget Milner, actually, in all this.
Well, no, I'm not forgetting Milner at all. Milner was probably, well, we've discussed it already in the previous pod, but Milner was probably one of my closest nominees for Man of the Match. Mates, did you say?
Closest friend.
Yeah. No, that's Naby. That's my name, Naby. But the point being is
barbecue.
The point being is Fabinho, Gav, and Matt. I don't know what you guys' opinions are, but he's been immense. But for the last 10 minutes in a couple of games, he seemed to have tired.
Not down to him.
Okay, go on.
I don't blame him at all.
Give it context.
I think if
he's
you look,
about 40 square.
Yeah, I think if you look at the game, like you know, the Leicester goal. Mm. All right, and then you have, and then if you go back to
the
Chelsea goal, what's happening with him is players may go by him, they may do, and he may be a bit tired. But you have to, people keep forgetting this. Wijnaldum and Henderson, as much as they're central midfielders, are there to cover right and left. That's what they're there for. When I go and watch Liverpool, I see this all the fucking time. And if you watch it, the match is being played, and the opposition have it. Whether it's out on the left or out on the right, you can guarantee Wijnaldum and Henderson are nowhere near the middle of the fucking park. You know what I mean? They're out on the left and they're going for it. Do you know the kind of way? So, I don't know. Like, I don't think you can blame Fabinho. He may have got tired, but I don't think it's down to his natural fitness that he's getting tired. I think he can just be overworked. And again, we just don't manage the game, right?
Okay, that's fair enough. But then, you know, there is an issue there then. Whether it's Fabinho's fault or he's covering too much ground or there's too much space in midfield, we do need to address that issue then.
Oh, it's very easily addressed.
Go on, give you a chance to give more context.
It's very easily addressed in the way that if you're needing to manage a game and you need to protect Fabinho just a little bit, all you do is tell Mane and Salah, listen, stop cheating the position you're in. Salah in particular, come back a little bit. Let us drop Henderson a little bit more central. You just look after the wing for a little bit until we can gather what we need to do, and we're fine. But the problem
depends
we have
on the game as well.
Yeah, exactly.
We've had to go for the win on a couple of occasions lately. So he's going to be exposed more because they're getting forward.
Yeah, but that's mad football.
That's just natural.
But if you look at the Red Bull Salzburg game, for argument's sake, we're 3-1 up at half time. We should have been coasting. We should have come out and took that ball and played and played and played and played and played until the heart went there with them. And then you probably could have picked them off for 4 or 5. We didn't. We kept going and going and going like absolute madmen. Fabinho's left in the middle of the park exposed. And the simple thing is, you just say to Salah, drop 20 yards for 10 minutes. For 10 minutes, just drop
it. The thing is, yeah, the only... And I'm not being a sort of... I'm not overanalyzing, but I'm just going to give you my opinion from what I saw. It is slightly worrying because the Leicester, the Salzburg and the Chelsea games, all three games where we're playing really well and control of the game, we lose control of all three games for a patch of about 15, and it's only 15, 20 minutes, but we do lose control for about 15, 20 minutes.
Allison sorts that.
I don't see how Allison sorts that, guys.
You just tell
us we don't concede
messing.
The goal.
I think, you know, is it this sort of, as you're talking about, Salah, you know, has to do more defensively, or do we just let him roam up there? Because he played a different role against Leicester as to what he does, you know, and sort of Mane was covering far more. Did we notice how many tackles
Mane
made?
Do you know what, Grizz? You talked earlier about Salah, and I know we're going well off the point here of the team we're picking, but you talked earlier about Salah and, you know, does he have to do this? And you talked about him going up front and through the middle and stuff. Why don't we... All I'm asking for, and listen, I'm not slating this team. I think they're a fucking phenomenal team. And listen, you can have games like Salzburg and the Leicester one, we are extremely unlucky, in my opinion. Chelsea, we should have been out of sight before they got back into it. But all I'm saying is, if we can look at a game after 55, 60 minutes, where we're 3-1 up or 2-1 up or 3-0 up, whatever it is, all you have to say is, do you know what, Mane, just come over to the right here for a minute. Firmino, just drop left. Sally, you go on and stay up there if you want to stay up there. Right, but these two boys are just going to drop 20 yards. They're going to make it compact. They're going to give Fabinho a breather by allowing Henderson and Wijnaldum to get closer to him. And then after that 10 minutes, when the other team blow their load, we can just take it on again, move yous back up front and tear them apart. That's all I'm saying. It's not me calling for fucking massive change. It's just a 10-minute segment in a game where we can still control a game just a slight bit deeper and a little bit more conservative. And it takes the heart out of other teams at the same time.
Fair enough. Well said.
Thanks. So the midfield three, we're going with the normal three. I have a feeling Keita might get a look in there. Up front, lads, the front three, normal lads, yeah? Matt?
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Normal lads. Grizz?
Well, yeah, if we're going with that midfield, then the front three stay the same.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think there's a mad shout.
What if we don't go for that midfield?
It's a mad shout about Gav and wanting to... Or is it wanting or you thinking...
I'm thinking, looking at, I don't think Fabinho is a concern. I think he finishes up with Brazil early enough and he'd be back. But just looking at Wijnaldum and Henderson. Now, Milner, don't forget him in there. He could come in. But I think against United midfield, where you'd look to be a little bit creative.
I think the extra day helps. I think the fact that we're playing Sunday afternoon is just brilliant for us.
It may do, but I just have a little inkling on Keita. That's all.
Do you want Keita to start though? If it was up to you.
No, if it was me, I'd definitely like Fabinho there. I'd definitely like Wijnaldum there because one, I think Wijnaldum is brilliant at holding onto the ball, moving us up the pitch when he needs to.
In this game,
if Pogba plays, he'd hound Pogba. He won't give him a minute. The Henderson one, not too bothered over. I think he's brilliant defensively for us, although what other people will tell you on Twitter, because they're off their fucking rocker, to be perfectly honest with you. I think he's brilliant defensively for us, and because we think United might go down that side, it might be very, very, you know, obvious to go and use Henderson there. But I just think Keita, if we're going to take one of them out because of what they've done in international break, I think Keita might get a sniff or a start, that's all.
What about you, Matt? Would you think of Ox or Keita?
As long as Fabinho and Genie are there, I'm happy for any of them three to come in.
Yeah.
As the link between midfield and attack. I'm cool with any.
I mean, there's no doubt Ox and Keita have to get some form of game time now. I'm not talking about the Rumble's Cup. I'm talking about in actual league games now.
The Rumble's Cup.
They've got to make their presence felt now in terms of letting the other two rotate. So I just don't think this is the. I know we've just cussed down United, but I don't think this is the game to experiment.
Okay, I think in a game where we control it a bit more, I think Keita will be the show. I think in a game where we could be where Klopp might sit back and look to hit them on the break, if and this is only if he doesn't go Wijnaldum or Henderson, one of them. I think Milner might be a good show. And I think if it's a game where later on where we're looking to, you know, hold what we have but hit them, I think Oxlade-Chamberlain is a great option. So there's three different options there for three different scenarios. But all being said, I think he will go with his normal three midfield and his normal three up front as normal. Matt, where do we hurt these on Sunday? Because I agree with you. I don't think
Old Trafford.
Yeah, I don't see us being overly hurt by this. I think if they do score, it'll be on a break or it could be a fucking dodgy goal or, you know, a mistake by us, whatever it is. But where do we hurt these, Matt? Where is it? You know, we know the quality we have, but where do you think straight away we need to get at them right there and in this way?
Just get at the defence. It's terrible. Get at the defence. Just don't do anything we haven't been doing all season. We control the game. We switch it from right to left. We get the fullbacks in behind, and we punish them. We'll hit them on. We're an unbelievable side for set pieces. So when we get the corners and the free kicks in around the area, we're going to get a goal from there. I'd say we're getting three from open play and one from set piece.
It's 4-0.
4-0.
Okay, yeah, we're going, lads. And we've about 11, 12 minutes left, so this could be anything by the time we're finished. I think Matt's been watching too much of the rugby or the NFL. He's just at 7 points every time he scores, isn't it? But
it's the 49ers and 7-0, by the way.
Already the 49ers. Matt's new NFL love is the San Francisco 49ers, isn't it?
Yeah, go Niners.
Go Niners. Right. But Grizz, where do you think we hurt them? Do you think, is it as simple as Matt says, we just get at them, we just really high tempo, dominate them, and then look to just play around our box and open them
up? I've got a feeling that we may play in a similar formation that we played against Leicester, mm-hmm. for the fact that their core, their spine of their team is really slow and cumbersome. So you're looking at Lindelof, Maguire, and let's say Matic or Fred, who's playing James. As a GM, or David James. I think, you know, we may want to get away from Mane going one against one with Wan-Bissaka, who's pretty good one-on-one defensively.
I think if they let Mane go one-on-one with Wan-Bissaka, Mane tears him a fucking part.
Oh well, fair enough. That's an opinion.
No, I think Bissaka's a good defender.
I think Bissaka's a good defender one on one. Yeah, but I just think if Mane and Bobby get to play closer to Salah, very similar to basically the way we played against Leicester, I think we could really cause them damage because Maguire and Lindelof are big, massive lumps and gone, Matt Pot Kettle. But yeah, so they could cause them guys a lot of damage with intricate 1-2s around the edge of the area. I don't think Ole's in the class of Jose in terms of blocking up that middle. I don't think he's got the tactical nous to do that. So do you remember when United came to us and Jose in that first half totally blocked up the middle? I don't think Ole's got the nous to do that. So therefore, I think we could hurt them through the middle as opposed to out wide. That's just a hunch I got. And that's, I think, we'd probably get good joy. And then sort of let Ginny and sort of Henderson sort of just, you know, support the front three as they've been doing. Will we be brave with our fullbacks as we always are, as we usually are? This is what I'm looking forward to. If Klopp allows them to be as brave as we always are against any other opposition, because I genuinely think he froze, including the team and him froze. because he played Milner at right back, didn't he? He dropped Trent last season. But if he lets them have a free reign and let them play their natural game, then we could cause havoc. If he plays a more pragmatic approach, I don't think that will be, you know, the way to play this Man United team.
Yeah, absolutely fair point. I think the biggest thing on Sunday, and it may sound trivial, I think if Salah is allowed to play on the half-turn, I think United are in serious, serious trouble. What I noticed against United last season, especially at Old Trafford, was they didn't let Salah turn. They made him play with his back to goal for a vast majority of the game, and Salah didn't cop it. Salah should have came a bit deeper on the half-turn and took it, or he should have just spun and went in behind. He didn't. He spent an awful lot of time, you know, literally with the defender right behind him, and they were able to snap in, let him take a touch, and then snap in on top of him. I think if he plays on the half-turn, I think United are in massive trouble. I think Henderson and Wijnaldum are huge because they will protect fullbacks. You know, and I don't mean in we're going to be defensively, yeah, or defensive in the way we approach it, but the way they can say to Trent and Robertson, you go and make that man, and let those two lads are predominantly out wide, getting closer to Firmino, like you said, Grizz. Fabinho will be huge at just breaking things up. Van Dijk and Matip will look after whatever they need to look after. They have to be careful of little things down the side. That's what I think the biggest issue will be. I don't think it'll be early. I don't think it'll be intricate. I think it will be just down the channels and try to walk from there. Firmino,
I mean, I just don't think they've got the confidence to play through us.
No, I don't think so either.
Not that they are a footballing team. And then, you know, the outlet will be mainly Rashford running into the channels, which,
yeah, but you see,
you know, hopefully Klopp has sort of rectified and mastered, because a couple of teams have had success with making runs into the area of Trent.
Yeah, but you're saying that, but then, you know, you look at Leicester last week and you would have thought they were a model for it, and they never got anywhere near it. Nowhere fucking close to it. You know, Liverpool will just have to deal with that as it comes, you know. I don't think they will play through us, but United have to be very, very careful here. If they come out all guns blazing and, you know, trying to impress the crowd and try to get up early and try to catch Liverpool on the hop, they could be in serious trouble. But if they come out ultra defensively, the crowd will get on their back extremely fucking quickly. So they have to be careful that way. You know the kind of way? So, United's approach, it could have a bearing on what happens. Because I think too gung-ho or too defensively, they're in trouble. They might like a game where it's congested in the middle of the park, but that means that there's room in behind. So I just think it's made for Liverpool. I know where you're coming from, Grizz, from the outset. You said, I'm just not sure, because it is Manchester United away, because they're the biggest rivals in the league, forget Everton and anyone else. So I know where you're coming from on that. But I just feel that, even forgetting last season, because you do forget it, I just think going there, we have to walk into Old Trafford on Sunday going, we are the fucking dog's bollocks, and we're about to show you why. You know what I mean? So, but Matt, you've had 1.5 more sips of beer since I spoke to you last. give me a prediction, Matt. And be a serious prediction, Matt. Just don't say 5, because you said 4 a minute ago.
they don't score. We score multiple. 2-3, 4-0, something like that.
Okay.
But if it's 2-0, it's a battering, and we just didn't get the rubber green.
Okay.
We'll get enough XG for 4-0.
Enough XG, and that gets you extra points now, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You get bonus points.
So we could be on, what, 28 points at the end of the season, at the end of the weekend?
28.00000.
0-0, just like the Niners.
Yeah.
Okay.
Go Niners.
Grizz, you predicted a draw at the very outset. You have done all week. Have we, this discussion, done anything to change your mind?
You have. Okay. Matt's done fuck all.
Matt said Daniel James holding midfield, and I forgot to go straight in for 3 or 4-0.
Yeah, if that's the case. You've made some very good points, and I'm gonna still stick with 1-1, but you've got a whole week to convince me yet, so we'll see how the week progresses. If we manage to beat these, and we manage to beat this comfortably, tell you what, that's some marker for us. That's I'm telling you, that's a statement and a half from us.
I don't think it is anymore.
Because, no, I'll tell you why. Because of the fact that we've frozen there in the last couple of years, and we've been the better team for the last couple of, for the last four or five seasons, we've been better than them. Yet we still haven't beaten them at their ground. So for that very reason, I think it will be a marker. And it will definitely, definitely make me more confident about our title charge. I hope I'm wrong, and I hope you guys are right, and we smash them.
Okay. So, have you given me a prediction?
Have I?
No, you just talk for ages without giving me a prediction.
I'm going 1-1.
Oh, what a wanker.
I think Ole Gunnar Solskjaer would love for this to come out and be one of those heroic United performances against all odds, you know, and sticking it to media. And the media would love nothing more than United win at the weekend. Let's be honest about
it. Oh, yeah.
I just think he's too naive. I think he's trying to... Do you know what? He's trying to please people and he's getting fucking worse. He's making the team worse at the same time. And I just think... something that Matt said at the very start stuck with me. Klopp will have a plan for this. You know, he'd look at last season, he'd look at how they're playing, he'd look at what might they might have available, and he'll have a plan. And whether that's when we're, if we're winning after 70 or losing, he'll have a plan. I'm going to go with 3-1 Liverpool. I think we bury them. But they might get one back as a consolation, but I think 3-1 Liverpool would be my prediction. Before we leave, lads, random questions. I have to ask one or two. Grizz, name something you've tried and would never ever try again.
Cucumber up the bum.
Salad.
I haven't tried that one.
A diet.
Keto.
Okay, good one.
Keto is the one, isn't it?
Look, you can laugh at keto, right? But yeah. I tried it. I tried it for a month and it worked, but it's really hard. Yeah, Matt did warn really me at the start. It's tough, and he was right.
But after a month, you were walking around and people were calling you Joel. So you know what I mean.
I'm actually going to start the keto again tomorrow.
No
but
way.
I'm going to try a refined version of it.
Yeah.
He's just not having brunch.
He's going to eat whatever he wants and then go. I remember keto, that was great, wasn't it? That's the reform.
No, it actually works. Look, on a serious tip, for anyone who wants to sort of ask me for diet advice, I will definitely recommend.
Save your money. Go down to Boots.
Forget the rest. Keto is the way to go.
Yeah.
It hasn't worked on me, but there's reasons, right?
But yeah, you're the reason.
But genuinely, it's the fucking best diet out there. It's amazing, and it makes you feel better. But back to your original question.
It's not a good diet if you can't keep it up.
Yeah.
It's a shit diet.
No, amazing you can't
diet.
Keep it up.
Amazing diet. Fucked in the bin after a month.
Come on. millions keep it up. It's just me. I haven't kept it up.
Yeah.
So, Gav...
Do you know those diets where you do things and like you have support groups and all? And like mad Americans ring you and go, oh my God, man. And they go, you know, you've done so well. Like, could you imagine Grizz being in the support group and they ring go, how'd you go and fuck her off? It's a great diet. Stick with it, bud, but I'm not on the head.
No one's going to ever change my mind. It's the best diet out there. I just gave it up.
Grizz, you gave it up after a month.
No, it's brilliant.
And you had 2 cheat days a week, so there was only fucking 20 days.
No, you can't. You don't even look any different.
I did a month ago when I tried it, remember?
You didn't.
You said I changed, you liar, you bastard.
You put weight on.
But listen, back to the original question. Yeah. I'm not joking. All back right. in the day, there's a very, very famous place in East London, in my land, right? in the land of the craze. Famous bagel place. It's an amazingly famous, it's like 24 hours. Some of the viewers, listeners might know about it.
Right.
I can't remember what it's called. So back in the day, after a night out with the lads, everyone recommended it. And they forced me, not forced me, they said, you know, to be honest with you, I didn't know what a bagel was back in the day, right?
Mm.
You know, so they said, look, I'm serious, I'm being honest.
Fucking bagel.
So I didn't know what it was. So I tried, and to me, it looked like a donut, right?
Yeah.
A glazed donut.
Straight in.
So,
have a chocolate bagel, please.
Yeah. So I thought this might be nice, but they gave me a salmon bagel, salmon and something else. Salmon and gherkin, salmon, anchovy, something like that, right? Mm. It's basically the best seller.
Yeah.
I puked up, and I'll never, ever, ever, ever try that ever again. That taste to this very day is still in my tongue. I can still remember that vile, vile taste of that smoky smoky
salmon. Yeah.
Bagel. It was awful, but it's apparently the fucking most amazing bestseller bagel in in the whole of London.
It's just not for you. Everyone else likes it, but it's not for you.
I'll never try that again. Yeah.
Matt, what have you tried and you would never try again, other than trying to get Grizz to stick to keto?
being friends with Grizz.
Oh, yeah.
What would I do? Ah, that cinnamon challenge thing.
Oh, have you tried that?
You can't even breathe for like a week. It's disgusting. you end up pissing out cinnamon.
Yeah.
It gets right under your bell end and everything.
Oh, right. Jesus. And like,
it doesn't.
And you,
no, I won't, yeah, I won't do that.
You've done some stuff now that I'd say has affected your bell end and pissing and stuff like that.
Well, like Chris's wife.
Jesus Christ. That might be a step too far. I bet you his battery goes now. You're going to leave. Pretend you upset. For me, it's the drink Pernod and Blackcurrant. Tried it, drank a fucking lot of it one night, and my God, never, ever, ever again. It's not that you feel violently ill if you drink too much of it. It's just the smell of fucking Pernod is just, it's a great idea at the time, but it's absolutely not after. So Pernod and Black would be
Pernod. That's the type of stuff he used to rob out my mum's drinks.
Oh man, they used to do it in this kind of nightclub and where I'm from, and you go up and be like, you know, double Pernod and Black for like 3 fucking quid. It was fucking horrendous. Great at the time, but no. Not after that. Last one. Grizz, your least favourite form of transport? Apart from that bike. Apart from that bike in the front of your telly. What's your least favourite,
Camel.
Yeah.
Why? Well, no, because I'm telling you, I've done it. I've tried it. I mean, I know, you know, Matt's in the country of Camels at the moment,
mm-hmm.
but it's horrible.
Liverpool.
It's horrible. Oh, not at the moment. Sorry. Yeah, you're fucking in the UK, aren't you, at the moment? Yeah. Camel Journeys, if anyone's tried it.
Not good.
Oh, it's not, Gav. It proper makes you, because you're really high up, but you're not high up enough
like
to
on
be
a horse.
Sort of flying. Do you know what I mean? You're like, yeah.
Hold on. You're not, are you trying to tell me you're not far off the sensation that you're flying?
Okay, so look. So, like, you're on a double-decker bus,
it's
right?
It's a fucking bumpy bike.
Camel is the height of a double-decker bus.
No, it's like the equivalent of being high enough to be on a double-decker bus, but it's open.
Hold on. The equivalent of sitting on a double-decker bus. If you're at the top of a double-decker bus, you're about 18 feet from the ground.
Big Camel, Gav.
Was it, you sure it wasn't a giraffe you were on?
No, it was a camel. 100%, it was a camel. Okay. So you're feeling sick, but you shouldn't be feeling sick, if you know what I mean.
Mm. Travel sickness.
It's not, yeah, so it's really, really bad. And it's really, really...
It's from the diet.
Apart from the obvious, it's really bumpy and uncomfortable. It's like, you know, your bell end's really, really sore afterwards.
Your bell end. Why is it so sore afterwards?
It's really, really sore afterwards.
Would you not have one of them cups from your cricket days you could have stuck on?
You're not meant to stick it in him after you ride it.
Yeah, but it all depends if you go for the cheap sort of guide.
You went for the all-inclusive, did you?
Yeah, so I went for the cheap guide where I think he used his scarf or something.
What's the message your bell end?
Yeah, it was really, really bad. That's the worst form of transport, because I can't imagine. So you've got to remember, these camels were used for people used them from traveling from countries to countries across deserts, hundreds and thousands of miles. I fucking couldn't do 10 meters, Gav.
Hundreds of thousands of miles on a camel.
Yeah.
To get from Dyson to Liverpool is 7,000.
Is it really?
You think people are going to hunt us?
Talking.
If you rewind the tape,
to America, the scenic route.
if you rewind, way for some water.
If you rewind, I said 100, 2,000.
Well, you didn't. You didn't.
I think you said hundreds of thousands.
I didn't say 100,000. I said 100 to 1,000 miles. Oh, you know, trips. I did, man. Already, so okay. All these merchants back in the day.
You just imagine. Australia. You just imagine Grizz on the Stennis ceiling, couldn't you? You know, Holly head to Dublin and be camel off to America.
It's a pretty bad way to move about in.
Okay.
So yeah, you'd give that a miss if I was you.
Ma, what is your least favorite form of transport?
Probably swimming. You get to the office and you're just soaked. Yeah, you get anywhere.
Is that a form of transport?
Yeah, it gets you from A to B, doesn't it?
Does it?
Does.
Okay.
Mr. Khan's left, his battery's gone.
Yeah, I have you. Sorry, his battery died. We'll sort it out. Is swimming transport, though?
Yeah, you'd say walking is.
Walking is a form of transport?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, just because you don't do it.
No, I do it, but I wouldn't have thought...
You go running these days, don't you?
You know, how did you get here? Oh, well, what mode of transport did you take to get
Swam.
Here? I walked. I don't know. Maybe. I don't know. Swam. Anyway,
will we
leave it there because Grizz has gone off and he's all pretendy upset?
Yeah.
All right, cool. Listen, that's been the Fatback 4. We've done everything on Manchester United versus Liverpool. We're pretty conclusive, bar Grizz, that Liverpool are going to win. Listen out during the week for the Fatback 4 daily, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday night. Not on tomorrow night. The club is being recorded tomorrow night. So the club tomorrow, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, is the Fatback 4 daily. Matt, thanks a million for joining me.
Go Niners.
Go Niners. Grizz, you're not there. Rest in peace. Thanks for joining me. But always remember, Grizz once travelled thousands of miles on a camel. He didn't go all inclusive because he's a miserable bastard. And the fella that was his guide used a scarf to play with his bell end. Over and out.